God bless you. It's Christmas service.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. And then press again.
To the newborn king, peace on earth.
The door opened and the innkeeper said, "What do you want?"
Have you a bed for the night, please? My wife is very tired, but we have come a long way.
I am very sorry, the innkeeper said, shaking his head. There is no room for you here. If you would like to stay in the stable with the animals, you are welcome to rest there. It is warm and dry.
Thank you. That will be very well.
They followed the innkeeper back to the little stable area that was full of animals. And it was there, in that humble place where Jesus was born. There was a little manger there, and Joseph scooped up some straw and laid it there in the manger. Outside of Bethlehem, in the fields, there was a flock of sheep. Among them watching the sheep so that they would not get lost or be harmed by wild beasts and run away, there were shepherds. The shepherds sat around the fire, talking quietly among themselves. Suddenly, an angel stood before the shepherds. Around him shone the dazzling light of the glory of God. The shepherds were terribly frightened. One of the angels said,
"Do not be afraid. I bring you wonderful news. Your Savior has been born in Bethlehem."
Suddenly, there was a great crowd of angels in the sky. And they all began to sing,
"Glory to God in highest, and peace on earth to men of good will."
At last, one of the shepherds said,
"Let us go to Bethlehem and see the thing that God has told us about."
They got up quickly and hurried to Bethlehem. When they arrived at the place where the star was over, they found it was just as the angel had said. There in the stable was Mary and Joseph and Jesus lying in the manger. It was God's own son.
Christian, and then when he said, what would the others do when there is trouble?
In Italy, 92% are Christians. What do the others do when they're in trouble?
In Great Britain, there are 87% Christians. What will the others do when there is trouble?
In New Caledonia, there is 87% Christians. What will the others do when there is trouble?
In India, there is 2% Christian. What will the others do when there is trouble?
In Nepal, 0% of the people are Christians. What do they do when there is trouble?
In Jordan, there's 2% of Christians. What do the others do when there is trouble?
In China, there's 0.2% of Christians. What do the others do when they're in trouble?
In Guyana, 2% of them are Christians. What do the others do when there is trouble?
In Kenya, there are 73% Christians. What do the others do when there is trouble?
Thank you. Sing together hymn 115, Joy to the World, the Lord is Come.
Thank you. and she was calling in a clear voice, "Rags!" The air was foul and the first light filthy to be crossed by such sweet music. "Rags! New rags for old! I take your tired rags. Rags!" Now, this is a wonder, I thought to myself, for the woman was 6 feet tall, and she walked tall and erect, and her eyes flashed intelligence. Could she find no better job than this? To be a ragman in the inner city? I followed her, my curiosity drove me, and I wasn't disappointed. Soon the ragman saw a woman sitting on her back porch. She was sobbing into a handkerchief, sighing and shedding a thousand tears. Her knees and elbows made a sad X. Her shoulders shook. Her heart was breaking. The ragman stopped her cart. Quietly, she walked to the woman, stepping around tin cans, dead toys, and Pampers. "Give me a rag," she said so gently, "and I'll give you another." She slipped the handkerchief from the woman's eyes. The woman looked up, and the ragman laid across her palm a linen cloth so clean and new that it shined. She blinked from the gift to the giver. Then, as the ragman began to pull her cart again, she did a strange thing. Putting the woman's stained handkerchief to her own face, she began to weep, to sob as grievously as she had done, her shoulders shaking. As the woman was left, without a tear. "This is a wonder," I breathed to myself, and I followed the sobbing ragman, like a child who cannot turn away from mystery. "Rags, rags, new rags for old." In a little while, when the sky showed gray behind the rooftops and I could see the shredded curtains hanging out black windows, the ragman came upon a girl whose head was wrapped in a bandage, whose eyes were empty. Blood soaked her bandage. A single line of blood ran down her cheek. Now the tall ragman looked upon this child with pity, and she drew a lovely yellow bonnet from his cart. "Give me a rag," she said, tracing her own line on the child's cheek, "and I'll give you mine." The child could only gaze at her while she loosened the bandage, removed it, and tied it to her own head. The bonnet she set on hers, and I gasped at what I saw, for with the bandage went the wound. Against her brow, it ran a darker, more substantial blood. Her own. "Rags! Rags! I take old rags!" cried the sobbing, bleeding, beautiful, intelligent ragman. The sun hurt both the sky now and my eyes. The ragman seemed more and more to hurry. "Are you going to work?" she asked the man who leaned against the telephone pole. The man shook his head. The ragman pressed him. "Do you have a job?" "Are you crazy?" sneered the other. He pulled away from the pole, revealing the right sleeve of his jacket, flat, the cuff stuffed into the pocket. He had no arm. "So," said the ragman, "give me your jacket, and I'll give you mine." Such quiet authority in her voice. The one-armed man took off his jacket. So did the ragman, and I trembled at what I saw, for the ragman's arm stayed in her sleeve. And when the other put it on, he had two good arms, thick as tree limbs, but the ragman had only one. "Go to work," she said. After that, she found a drunk, lying unconscious beneath an army blanket. An old man, hunched, wizened, and sick. She took that blanket and wrapped it around herself. But for the drunk, she left new clothes. And now, I had to run to keep up with the ragman. Though she was weeping uncontrollably and bleeding freely at her forehead, pulling her cart with one arm, stumbling for drunkenness, falling again and again, exhausted, old and sick, yet she went with terrible speed. On spider's legs, she skittered through the alleyways of the city, this mile and the next, until she came to its limits, and then she rushed beyond. I wept to see this change in this woman. sorrow. And yet, I needed to see where she was going in such haste, perhaps to know what drew her so. The little old rag man, she came to a landfill. She came to the garbage pits. And then I wanted to help her in what she did, but I hung back, hiding. She climbed a hill. With tormented labor, she cleared a little space on that hill. Then she sighed. She lay down. She pillowed her head on a handkerchief and a jacket. She covered her bones with an army blanket. And she died. Oh, how I cried to witness that death. I slumped in a junked car and wailed and mourned as one who has no hope. Because I had to come to love the ragman. Every other face had faded in the wonder of this woman, and I cherished her. But she died. I sobbed myself to sleep. I did not know. How could I know? That I slept through Friday night and Saturday, and it's night too. But then, on Sunday morning, I was awakened by a violence. Light, pure, hard, demanding light, slammed against my sour face. And I blinked and I looked, and I saw the last and first wonder of all. There was a ragman, holding the blanket most carefully, a scar on her forehead, but alive, and besides that, healthy. There was no sign of sorrow nor of age, and all the rags that she had gathered shined for cleanliness. Well, then I lowered my head and I trembled for all that I had seen. I myself walked up to the ragman. I told her my name would shame, for I was a sorry figure next to her. Then I took off all my clothes in that place, and I said to her, with dear yearning in my voice, "Dress me." She dressed me. My lord, she put new rags on me, and I would wonder, beside her, the ragman, the ragman.
Okay, why don't we sing that together in 122 with the orchestra, O Come All Ye Faithful, as we close. We stand and we sing this, and then Pastor Cho will pray for our benediction.
Sacrificed all your life. You emptied your life for us. You crucified yourself on the cross. You gave your life for giving us new life, eternal life, heavenly life. All through your suffering, we became glorious Son of God. Oh Lord, we really want to give you special thanks. Hallelujah. Oh Lord, help us and lead us. Oh Lord, give in our deep heart, sacrificing heart for others, for your glory. Oh Lord, sometimes we are very frustrated. Because we are too self-centered, egocentric life we live. Oh Lord, help us. Oh Lord, awaken us so we can be more sacrificial. Oh, we would become like you. So we really want you. Make you glorified. Now, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of our God our Father, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, now it's on. Dad, you're half battery. Again. You're half out of battery.
I'm half out of battery.
Yeah.
Now here's my Christmas song to you. Jesus loves you, this I know, 'cause the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, he is weak but We are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, there you go. Grandma, children, wife, everybody, Merry Christmas, and I love you with all my heart.
And let me close on the cross.
Like Father, let's see.
Here's the tree. There's the angel. And here is the church. There's a piano, windows, outside, door, one window, two windows. Back to the Christmas tree. This.
Really shooting me?
That's it.